Log Cabin Restaurant, owned and operated by Jimmy Blair, is proud to sponsor the telecast for 1985 PHS football. The Log Cabin features prime rib, steak, seafood, and your favorite drinks. They are open 4 p.m. to 12 p.m. Monday through Saturday. If you're looking for a very unique evening out, enjoy good food and good company, then put the Log Cabin Restaurant in your plans. PHS, number one in football. Log Cabin, number one in food. Visit the Log Cabin and thank Jim for bringing you PHS football for 1985. Now, sit back, relax, and enjoy. It is time for Eastern Kentucky's best, the Pikeville High School Panthers.
Well. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Pikeville High School, Phelps High School playoff football game here at Pikeville, Kentucky tonight. This is the first playoff game of 1986 for Pikeville, and their first in a couple of years, having not made it last year. Tonight with me is Andy Joyce. Chuck Dameron has gone out of town with some cheerleaders on some sort of contest or program, and he'll not be with us tonight, and we'll miss him very much. We miss him already. Tonight, Pikeville plays Phelps, and Andy, they've played this team once before this year, and had a rather lopsided victory. And I'm sure this is going to be difficult for Coach Howard to get his kids up with a good attitude to play a team again that they've defeated by a very large margin earlier in the year.
That's right, Neil, but one thing you've got to remember is Phelps led Pikeville 8-6 late in the second quarter, and Pikeville came on then to take the lead 14-8 at the half. But I'm sure that's still in their minds. And they'll remember that. They'll remember the final score, but they'll remember the score at halftime, too.
I think that's a good point. There was a time there where it was an afternoon game. As a matter of fact, I think it was Pikeville's homecoming. And there was a time there when a lot of people were very worried that perhaps Phelps could give Pikeville a real rough go of it, and Pikeville did come back in the second half. Andy, you do a lot of officiating in the area, and you've officiated many of our junior high football games that I help coach on a part-time basis. And you were telling me before we went on the air that you had the opportunity to referee the Phelps Elkhorn City game just a few weeks ago, which enabled Phelps to qualify for these playoffs. What observations did you make over there at Phelps regarding this football team?
Well, Elkhorn City had put together a pretty good offense all year with Anthony Looney, and he was just a real hard runner. And when he got to Phelps, it just seemed like he got up in line and he was just stopped. I think he ended up with something like 40 total yards on the night, and Phelps' defense just really rose to the occasion, and they put together two or three good drives on their offense.
Did, of course, from what you're telling me, it sounds like Elkhorn didn't play up to their abilities over there at Phelps, but did Phelps look like an improved team, although it was only a few weeks lapse between that football game, the football game in which they lost rather handily to Pikeville?
Well, It appeared that Phelps had improved since the Pikeville game, but I believe a lot of it could have been playing on emotion. It was for the sub-district title, and there is a bit of a rivalry between Phelps and Elkhorn City, whereas the past three or four years they've met for the sub-district title, and that game really means a lot. I think Elkhorn City's a better team, but Phelps is here playing Pikeville tonight.
Yes, indeed they are. Phelps has a quarterback that people over their way are very impressed with him. He's a very big kid. They don't have his size here, at least on the stats that I have, but I think he's supposed to be about 6'4", and he looks like he's about 200 pounds. Bobby Mullins, number 15. And as a result of his size, and, well, they list him at 6'4 and 210, they rely pretty heavily on him. They try to throw the ball a lot. Did he throw the ball much against Elkhorn?
They threw the ball a lot against Elkhorn. It was a little wet, not nearly as wet as it is tonight, but they did throw the ball a lot, and their big plays came when they threw the ball.
While we were discussing this, Andy, they're introducing the Pikeville starters on the field. Introducing the defense, the defensive starting lineup for Pikeville, and the offensive starting lineup for Phelps. Got a real muddy field tonight, and you commented a minute ago that it appeared that Pikeville was practicing and getting ready to at least anticipate playing with a rubber football rather than a leather football. I think, too, that perhaps this weather might have some effect on Bobby Mullins' ability to throw, although I didn't think he threw that well against Pikeville.
Right. I don't think either team's going to be able to throw the ball a whole lot. Phelps is dependent on it a lot all year, and as wet as it is tonight, I just really don't see how they can put together any kind of pass offense.
Well, I would agree with that, and of course, time will only tell whether or not they try to put the ball in the air. Pikeville, I would think without any doubt, has a better running game than Phelps, and they have a much bigger line.
Right. Phelps does have one back that they rely on a lot, and that's Mike Fannin. He's a junior. He's about 6'1", and close to 200 pounds, 190. He ran the ball a lot against Elkhorn. I would say he ran the ball close to 20 times, and he was picking up 3 and 4 yards at a chunk. Of course, the field wasn't as wet as it is tonight, so we'll see how he does with a little wetter field.
You know, again, too, I think with a field that's this slippery, it makes it even more necessary for a team to have good blocking up front, because there's not much juking and faking that a back can do if he gets up into the hole and there's nothing there.
That's right. They're really going to just have to blow the holes wide open. And I think Pikeville may be able to do that a little better than the Phelps team can.
Well, if the second half of the Phelps-Pikeville homecoming game here is any indication, you would think that indeed Pikeville has the upper hand and would be able to run the ball. At least in the second half in the previous game, Pikeville seemed to run the ball at will. Of course, they came out of the locker room with what appeared to be an entirely different attitude. They had much more enthusiasm. And I'm sure Hillard impressed upon them at the half during that game that they were indeed in a contest, and if they didn't play better, they had a chance of losing. Although it wouldn't have affected, I don't think, at that time, their playoff standing. You still don't like to lose to anybody, and particularly a team that you ought to beat.
Exactly.
Well, we're about to have the kickoff here. Back to kick for Pikeville's number 22, Sean Neely. Mike McCoy has been kicking of late for Pikeville. Sean perhaps puts a little more foot into the ball, but he doesn't seem to be as accurate as Mike does on the extra point attempts and the field goal attempts.
Looks like we've got Keith Daugherty and Mike Sinsail back deep for Phelps.
Okay. The viewers ought to realize that if we lose the flow of the game here on brief occasions, we're in a new press box up here now, Andy, and the thing was ordered with pictures having been given to the Board of Education, and the glass across the front of it was supposedly extending from one side to the other, and this one has large wooden panels in between different windows, which makes it difficult to see the ball on some points of the field, but we'll try to stretch out. And
we've got quite a few blind spots in here.
Yes, we do. We have a delay right now, and here's a whistle, and here's the kick, Sean Neely. Not a bad kick in this kind of weather, footing difficulty. Kicks it down to about the 15-yard line. It's taken by Phelps and returned to the 25. Andy, it looked like Sean was real cautious in kicking that ball.
It looked like he was just trying not to lose his footing.
It's very slippery out there already, and I'm sure it's going to get muddier as the night progresses. Phelps will have the ball on a 25-yard line, first and 10. Mullins comes in at quarterback, very quickly calls the play. Phelps with two wideouts to the right, and Pikeville sends one defensive back and Link Rance out to cover. Mullins back, he fakes and throws long. Ooh, a great interception, a great interception.
That was a great defensive play by Brian Mahan. He let the receiver get behind him, but the ball was underthrown, and he was right there to pick it off.
Yes, he did. Sometimes a defensive back like that, big turnover here early in the game, sometimes a defensive back, if he feels he has the speed to retreat and catch the pass receiver, will let the guy get by him for a second just to try to bait the quarterback. I hope that's what Brian was doing. Otherwise, a bad pass simply resulted in an interception for Pikeville. Gene Pinson with the ball, and he turns and hands off to, I think, Andy Williamson. And he picks up about 1 yard. Looks like they're going to have a difficult time of it.
I don't know if he lost his footing because of the mud, or if he just got tripped up, but he sure lost his feet rather easily right there.
He did. He went down fast, and Pikeville got only 1 yard out of that one. Second down and 9. Gene Pinson up to the ball. Takes a snap, turns, fakes to Andy Williamson. And I think Gene was trying to run a bootleg on that play, Andy, and it was a naked bootleg, and Phelps didn't buy it at all, and they dropped Gene for a 7 or 8 yard loss back to the 38-yard line.
They were all over him there.
Boy, they were. And that, again, that's a naked bootleg where you just hope that the defense will go with the flow and the fake, and they didn't do it. As a matter of fact, the entire right defensive line just waited there for Gene and buried him for an 8 yard loss. Third down and about 16. Gene drops back and throws the ball to Brian Mahan. A nice catch at the 50-yard line, but again, he lost his feet almost as soon as he caught the ball.
All right, it's going to be fourth and about four now.
Pikeville obviously will kick. They're sending their punting unit in. That pass was just a little bit low, and to ensure that he made the catch, Brian sort of went to his knees before he caught the ball, making any kind of... Oh! That kick is blocked. Timmy McNamee tried to punt that one, and boy, I tell you, this Phelps team looks like they're ready to play.
They're right up the middle. Somebody's missed a block there because they were in there in a hurry on him.
Boy, they were all over him, but Timmy didn't have a chance at all to kick that ball, Andy, and the footing, as we've mentioned before, is so bad that there wasn't any way to hold the ball and fake it and run the ball.
Right.
Two big turnovers here early in the game, and Phelps gets the better of it, really, because they now have the ball on Pikeville's 46-yard line, first and 10, two wideouts left. Mullins with the ball. He turns and hands off to his tailback, who is number seven, Keith Daugherty. Neither team showing much offensively right now, Andy.
No. Looks like Pikeville's running a little bit of a 52 defense with five men up front, and they've got the four backs, two corners and two halfbacks back there.
Yeah.
Maybe to keep Bobby Mullins passing down.
I agree with you. That's certainly a pass defense more so than it is run.
Right. Somebody's jumped.
Somebody jumped, and I don't know who went first. The left tackle for Phelps jumped off sides, but we had two Pikeville players go off, and I think they're going to call penetration of the plane on Pikeville. Indeed, they are. Again, Andy, as we point out to the fans sometimes, they watch NFL football on Sunday, but in high school, you simply have to break the plane.
Right, you break the plane of the ball, and then you've encroached. In professional football, you do have to touch the player. If you get back and don't touch him, then you're okay. But in high school, all you have to do is break the plane.
Right. Mullins up second down and four. He turns and pitches to the Fannin boy, I believe. And Pikeville defends it very well, and there's a pickup of about a half a yard.
Trying to get outside, and I don't believe the footing's good enough to where he can cut it up quick enough to pick up anything. He didn't gain anything there.
That's a good point. I think, again, the footing is so bad that both teams are going to have to stay inside the ends, maybe inside the tackles.
Right, it's got to be tackle to tackle in this kind of weather.
You know, that's something that Gene tried to do on that first possession, again, on that naked bootleg. And the footing's so bad, it's hard to get an aggressive defender to take a fake. Phelps with the ball, third and four. Mullins drops back. He's going to pass. He's got a receiver coming across the middle. But he was tackled by,
I believe it's Bobby Duramus.
I think it was Bobby, just before he could release the ball.
They've got him in there at that nose guard, and that speed really pays off in there, and he's strong enough to fight off the blockers.
Well, that's unusual for a high school team to have probably their fastest player, Andy, and a tailback playing nose guard.
Right. He really is. He is well put together.
Yeah.
And he's really a stocky kid, but he is quick, too.
Phelps, fourth and four, and they're going to punt. There's the snap. And end-over-end kick rolls down. Oh, my goodness, was not fielded. Brian Mahan elected to stay away from that ball, Andy, and Phelps downs it way down there.
Yeah, it was a short kick. It bounced about 15 yards in front of him, and by the time that the ball got to him, the Phelps man was on him, so he had to let it roll, especially with the ball being wet. And it's down deep, it looks like, about the four-yard line.
Madge Baird's out here making faces at me, and it's difficult to announce with somebody like that doing that. I thought I would tell on her. Pikeville has the ball now and turn, and they hand off to...
Got a late flag there, Neil.
That was Chad Thornberry, and he ran the ball out to about the 11 or 12-yard line. Well, they mark it at the 10, but there is a flag.
It's the kind of flag usually on a play like that, a flag comes in that late. It's usually a face mask call.
Or unnecessary roughness piling on.
Right, a piling on or something going on on the down in the bottom of the pile, some kind of flagrant act.
Is that ordinarily a dead ball foul?
Ordinarily, yes.
Well, it's nice to have a referee up here with me tonight. Well, there seems to be some confusion out there.
It is a dead ball clip.
Oh, my goodness. Well, you don't see a clip very often on a play off the guard.
Not right up the middle. The flag was late in the middle there. That's a tough call to make. Of course, he's down there right on it. He can see that a little better than we can.
That's for sure. Well, Pikeville now with a first and 10. Well, it'll be second and 10.
It's like Hackney, was it?
Yeah, Hackney with the ball, and he takes it out to about the 10-yard line, a pickup of about 5. Andy, what I don't understand there, that must have been a half the distance to the goal. Is that what that was? Because it was
right,
first down
right,
over again.
Right, a clip is usually a 15-yard penalty, but it occurred, looks like about 10, so it would have been a half the distance penalty.
Gene Pinson takes the ball again and turns and hands off to Timmy Honecker straight up the middle. And there wasn't much there, but Timmy was there, and weighing about 250, it looks like he picked up the first down.
He's up there close.
Timmy Honecker coming in at 6'3", and about 240, 250 pounds, and he really has a lot of balance, Andy, for a big boy.
Right. And a big guy like that, he might be able to get his footing a little better than some of these smaller, quick guys on a field like this.
Right, and the defender will have a lot of difficulty tackling a fellow that big in this mud. Again, Gene turns off and hands off to the second back through, and it looked like Hackney again.
Boy, he's running hard tonight.
He is running hard. Didn't look like he had that much, and he dove for some extra yardage. Picked up about 8 yards on that, Andy.
Looks like we've got a whole new backfield coming in. Looks like Doramus, Neely, Mahan, and Thornsbury.
Yeah, they have Bobby Doramus in there at the left half back. They've got sort of a wing or veer formation. Hands off to the first back through. That's Chad Thornberry. Chad easily picks up the first down. Well, they've marked it back about a yard, but I think he still has it.
Looks like the line's getting a little explosion off there now, and the backs are finding the holes and just taking it right up the gut.
Yes, they are. Pikeville's offensive line is really coming off the ball, particularly on this series of play. Uh-oh. Well, I tell you, Gene, turn around. We may see a lot of that tonight. Phelps falls on that ball to 22 or 3-yard line, Andy.
Bright for Phelps.
Conditions like this, we could see an awful lot of that.
It's going to happen all night.
Gene looked like he was running what ordinarily people refer to as a misdirection play or a crossbuck, where he fakes the first back through on the right side and turns to hand off to the tailback or the trailing back. And he simply missed him. I don't think he ever touched him.
I don't think so.
Just dropped the ball on the ground. Phelps picks it up first and 10, 20-yard line of Pikeville. Phelps, again, hands off to the tailback coming through, the second man through. Pikeville defenses it very well. And doesn't appear that Phelps gained anything on that play. Well, they give them about 2 feet, maybe a yard.
Seems to me like Phelps' plays take a long time to develop. I don't know whether they're not coming off the ball or what, but it seems like they're taking an awful long time to develop back there.
Well, I think you're right. And then, too, if your backs line up too deeply in a condition like this, they can't get started.
Right.
Mullins comes back. Real good pass defense by Pikeville. Chris Newsom and Joey Miller both had their men covered very well.
Right. Sean Neely and Robbie Simpson came from behind and got Mullins before he could get a man open, because they were well covered.
Yeah, he pumped a couple of times and wanted to throw, but nobody was open. By the time he started to pump the third time, Pikeville had him in their grasp. And down he goes for about a 6 or 7 yard loss. It'll be third down and about 18 yards from the Pikeville 27-yard line for Phelps. We have an official timeout. Looks as though Sean Neely has a loose helmet strap or shoulder strap.
I believe he got a face full of mud on the last play, too.
This is going to be a sloppy game, and there's just no way to avoid it. Mullins over the ball. He takes a snap.
Like
We've got an illegal procedure on the left end there, Andy. Did you see that?
Looks like the left end raised up just before the snap, and the head linesman on that side did catch it.
He did indeed, and there wasn't any question about that.
I believe Pike will decline the penalty and take that 4th and 20.
Yes, they will. Well, it will be 4th and 20 now.
Looks like Phelps will probably go for it.
I'd say they will. They've got the ball on the 30-yard line.
It's kind of hard to punt from there, so even if you don't make it, you're down there deep.
You know, I think in these conditions, though, Andy, I would punt the ball because in the mud, it's not going to back up on you.
Right.
Mullins gets the ball. He drops back. He looks to the left. He throws a screen pass out to Fannin. There's a block on. There was a block on Link Ritz, and a real fine play by Link. He made the tackle anyway.
Link's looked real impressive. I haven't seen Pikeville play that much, but the games I've seen him play, I saw him play the Phelps game earlier and then in the bowl game, and Link has really impressed me this year.
Andy, did Fannin try to cut back and then just lose his footing and go into Link? Or?
It looked like that might have happened. I couldn't tell. It's on the far sideline.
I thought he had a lot of room to run there, and the only person that could have gotten him was Link, and he ran right into him. Gene Pinson, he turns and gets the ball to Greg Hackney. A real nice run. And as you said, Greg is running hard.
He is running real hard. He's just a sophomore. We can look for a couple more years out of him.
He will be a dandy. Well, he is already. Not very big, but very quick. And runs with a lot of authority.
He's a real tough kid, too.
Yes, he is. Second down and 2 for Pikeville at their own 42-yard line. Gene Pinson over the center. Takes a snap, turns, and gives again to big Timmy Honaker. Timmy shakes 2-3 tacklers and picks up about 10 yards down to the Phelps 48-yard line.
He's got 3 of these little cornerbacks hanging on him. Timmy's just carrying them like a loaf of bread, taking them home from the store.
It's awfully tough for a 145-pound cornerback to tackle a 250-pound tailback.
That's right. I was in that situation a few years ago.
Could be very rough. Gene Pinson takes the ball, turns, and gives to Andy Williamson over the left tackle. A lot of running room. Andy goes down to about the 32-yard line of Phelps, where it'll be 1st and 10. Boy, I tell you, Andy, again, the Pikeville offensive line appears to really be coming off the ball.
They're really coming off and giving the backs the room they need.
There was a big hole there for Andy Williamson that time, and he carried a couple of tacklers about 5 yards with him. It'll be 1st and 10 from the 34-yard line where they mark it. Gene Pinson takes the ball and gives to the second man through, which is Andy Williamson, tripped up at number 73.
It's Billy Smith getting through there, and he's been through there past 2 or 3 plays. He's getting through there quick, and he got a foot on Andy that time and tripped him up.
They list him at 5'8", 220 pounds, and he looks plenty heavy, but he looks taller than that.
Yeah, he does.
Oh, Pinson takes the ball, turns, and gives to...
Looks like DeRamus.
It was Bobby DeRamus, and he had 3 Phelps defenders just waiting on him. And I think they lost some yardage there, Andy.
Looks like it's going to be 3rd and 9.
It will be 3rd and 9 from the Phelps 33-yard line. Big down here if Pikeville expects to score. Gene Pinson turns and instructs his backs where to line up, takes the ball from center and turns and gives to Andy Williamson off the right tackle. And Andy could be gone. Oh, he's caught at the last second by a Phelps defender. But did he pick up the first down, Andy?
Looks like he's got the first down by a couple of yards. Pikeville ran a little crossbuck that time, and Phelps fell for the fakes, and it was wide open.
Tell you what, Keith Daugherty, the left cornerback for Phelps, who's 5'8 and 150 pounds, just was able to grab a hold of his jersey as he went by, or Andy could have gone for a touchdown there. It'll be 1st and 10 from the Phelps 21-yard line. Gene turns and gives to Greg Hackney. And Greg runs it hard up in there for about 3 or 4 yards. It'll be 2nd and 6, a long 6, from about the Phelps 18 or 17-yard line. Well, Pikeville has put it in the air one time. They've been successful. And since that, they've stayed on the ground. Pinson takes the ball from the center, turns and gets the first back through. That's Andy Williamson. He picks up about 2 or 3 yards down to the Phelps 15-yard line, where it'll be 3rd down and a long 4. Well, Andy, in this particular field position, I would think that they have 2 opportunities here.
I would think so. It being this wet, you don't know how your field goal kicker is going to do. but you do have that alternative.
Well, I think we're going to see precisely what we were just talking about, whether and Hillard will, I'm sure, go for the first down. As Timmy Honecker ran that ball up through the middle of the line and came up short about a half yard. So it'll be fourth.
Not much more than half a yard short.
No, it certainly isn't. It's fourth and about a half yard from the Phelps 12-yard line. Pikeville sends a wide receiver out left, Robbie Wright. Gene Pinson turns and gives the ball to big Timmy Honecker.
Looks like
and that's going to
be
very close.
Looks like the ball could be loose in there, Neil.
Well, apparently the referees felt that either the ground caused the fumble or that there wasn't a fumble. And they're going to measure it. There really wasn't much there, was there, Andy?
No, there wasn't. No, there wasn't. They piled up in there.
The ref comes out with the chain. Oh.
Looks like they just got it by the nose.
Well, I tell you, they didn't get that first down by much more than a couple of inches. But it will be first down and 10 for Pikeville at the Phelps 11-yard line. We have a minute and 3 seconds left in the first quarter of play. No score in the game as yet. Pinson over the center. He takes a snap, turns, and gives to Bobby DeRamis. There wasn't anything there. It looked like there was some confusion there on Gene Pinson in the backs.
Yeah, it did. It looked like there was supposed to be someone there he could fake to or someone there to pick up a defensive player for a block, and then there just wasn't anybody there.
Exactly right. I think your lead back, your fullback, was supposed to go over to the right tackle and bust off there and make that block, and he went to the left, and Gene Pinson looked for him and didn't see him, and then gave to DeRamis. There was nothing there. Second and 10.
Throws a quick look in to Robbie Wright. He's in for the touchdown.
Touchdown, Pikeville. Well, they go to the air, and it's successful. That was a nice play.
That's just a basic quick look in off a play action. Really, you fake your dive and then just raise up and throw it. It's just a real quick pass.
Well, it certainly surprised Phelps. That's the first time we've seen Pikeville throw the ball since their first possession early in the first quarter. So with 25 seconds to go, Pikeville puts a touchdown on the board and will now try the extra point attempt with Mike McCoy kicking, trying to make this game 7-0 Pikeville. Mike's had some very good games. I think he kicked 5 or 6 extra points in a row a few games back, and that's
got a flag drop, Neil. Referee signals it is good, but there is a flag down.
Well, that's one of the better kicks I've seen Mike hit this year. That came off the swimming pool cover. There's some discussion there with the referees.
Can't really tell which team they're talking to. Looks like they might be going to kick it again.
I think they are. They've gone down to the original ball placement, and they're coming back, quite a few yards. Or is he just coming back to pick up his flag?
I believe it's going to be a 5-yard penalty, so it'll be from the 8-yard line this time. Try to pick up what the penalty was. I didn't see any motion at the snap. And that's a failure to wear equipment against Pikeville. So someone's had a mouthpiece out or a strap hanging or something.
Well, that's a careless error and could be costly.
Looks like there's motion there, and I believe that was Phelps. From where the way I could see it, it looked like the Phelps man came across.
The referee is indicating to the Phelps defensive line, so we'll get that 5 yards back. They are marching the penalty yardage off toward the Phelps goal line. So we'll have the ball back on the original marking.
The umbrellas have come back out, Neil. Looks like it's going to rain some more.
Well, we spoke a couple of games ago about what a perfect night for football it was, and this one is rather imperfect.
There's Phelps offside again. We'll take him halfway the distance to the goal line this time.
This extra point is taking a while.
I believe I would decline it from here and just leave it where you're used to kicking it from anyway.
Well, you know, if we keep getting closer, Andy, Hillard might change his mind and go for two.
Looks like he might be doing that now. He's sending in 3 or 4 players, and I believe he is going to go for two.
By golly, he is. He's sending an almost entirely new offensive unit in.
He's got a yard and a half to go. You'd expect him to go to Honecker in this situation. I don't see him in there.
You know, I don't either. I don't see Timmy Honecker in there either. You would expect that, to give it to your 250-pound fullback with a yard and a half to go. He has Hackney and Andy Williamson back at the tailbacks. Pinson takes the ball for snap, turns and gives to Andy Williamson, and he's easily in there standing up. So rather than a pad, it's a two-point conversion, and with 25 seconds left, it's Pikeville 8, Phelps nothing left in the first quarter. 25 seconds left in the first quarter, and Pikeville ready to kick off after taking an 8-0 lead. And Andy, they looked rather authoritative on that drive. Nothing pretty about it, but pretty forceful.
They just took it right down Phelps' throat that time.
Well, they did indeed.
Looks like Mike McCoy is going to kick off this time.
Well, he is. We've got a new kicker. Oh.
He shanked that one.
He did shank it. Looked like one of my wedge shots. Picked up by number 24 for Phelps and returns it to the Phelps 34-yard line, but we have a flag on the play.
That's Mike Fonner for Phelps. We've got a flag down, and you're looking at either a clip or a legal use of hands in that type of flag right there.
Well, again, I'm glad we've got somebody up here that knows what all of those signs are that these referees give us.
What you don't know, you got to fake, Neil. Make people believe you know it.
Oh, well, they're marching off
like a 10-yard penalty. That'd probably be a legal use of hands, and that's what it is.
So that'll put Phelps back at their own 25-yard line, where it'll be first and 10 with 19 seconds left in the first quarter, and we have a steady rain coming down. Bobby Mullins, the quarterback for Phelps, comes up under center. Tight formation, two tight ends. He turns and gives to his tailback.
Daugherty, and there's nothing there.
There's absolutely nothing there. Daugherty only weighs 150 pounds, Andy, and he's running against a Pikeville defensive line that probably averages well over 220. And that's the end of the first quarter, with Pikeville ahead 8-0 over Phelps. On 25-yard line, second and 9. And we're beginning the second quarter of play here at the Hamlet Athletic Center in Pikeville. Bobby Mullins takes the ball from center, turns, and gives to his tailback. And, Andy, they seem to be determined to stay with the run on this series of play, and it's not getting them anything at all. You know, I know conditions aren't very conducive to passing, but I think Phelps absolutely will have to put the ball in the air if they have any chance of winning this game. Again, they have a tight formation. Mullins takes the ball. He turns and fakes to his back, gives to a back coming back across in sort of a reverse, but it's played very well by Brian Mahan as he stretches it out and holds containment, Andy. Well, it'll be a fourth down situation for Phelps with 7 yards to go, and I'm sure they're bringing in their punting unit. Rain still coming down. Pikeville has Robbie Wright and Brian Mahan deep. Center by Phelps. Oh, they nearly blocked that one. Bobby DeRamus came very close to blocking that, and he caused a bad kick, Andy, out at the Phelps 40-yard line. You know, I think if the Phelps kicker had kicked that the way you ordinarily would, and that's from inside out with your right foot, Bobby would have blocked that kick. I'm sure that he was. It was pretty obvious that Bobby was there and was about to block the kick when he shanked it to his left. Pikeville using that rubber football this time. Gene Pinson over center, takes a snap, turns, he fakes. Oh, boy, he's trying to run that quick look in again. Right, that play is designed for a quick play fake and then a real quick raise up and throw. And when it wasn't there, Phelps was able to defend it and tackle him before he had an opportunity to scramble. Pinson again over the center, a tight formation. He turns and fakes again. He's throwing this time to Link Ritz, and Link simply couldn't get outside.
Looks like he's spinning out in the mud, not getting very much traction at all.
That's a good description of that spinning out, because Link went down about 10 yards and was going to cut outside on a flag route to the corner. And when he started to make his cut, he didn't go anywhere.
Right. On a dry field,
yes, he did. It looked like a car spinning its wheels in the mud. Pikeville comes out with a 3rd-and-11 situation, and I'm sure they'd like to convert here. And you would think certainly that they would pass in this situation. Gene's back. He throws down the middle. Ooh, he had Link wrist wide open. But again, it looked like Gene couldn't get his hand on the ball.
Looked like the ball slipped just as he threw it. He got the ball there.
Yeah, he unable to grip the ball very well. He threw the ball way behind Link, and Link went to his knees to try to catch it, but he didn't have any chance at all. So Pikeville will punt from its own, or rather from Phelps' 40-yard line. That is John Blackman, and he sort of shanks that ball a little bit, but it turns out to be a great kick. It rolls out of bounds at the 11-yard line of Phelps. So Phelps will take possession at their own 11 or 12-yard line with 9:40 left in the second quarter. You know, John, in the Paintsville game, Andy, had a tremendous game punting. And then I think it was last week, we didn't see John punt at all, and I didn't understand that.
I haven't seen five play that much. But I understand they do have three or four punters that aren't they?
Well, John, by far, has done the best job that I've seen. Phelps turns and pitches to their halfback over the left side, and he gets out just past the line of scrimmage for a pickup of maybe 1 yard. But in that Paintsville game, I thought John Blackburn was one of the key performers in that game, enabling Pikeville to win, and a big, big win it was. And John averaged, I'll guarantee you, 40 yards a kick in that game. He really does. He gets a good foot into it. You know, that was a bad kick, and it went 30 yards and went out of bounds on the 10. You couldn't ask for a better kick. Phelps with the ball. Mullins turns around and fakes, and he hands off to his tailback up the middle on what appeared to be a draw of some sort. Well, that was Troy Gooseland. That was their fullback. He's 5'8 and 185, and he picked up 8 yards on that for a real nice game. That's the biggest game of the night for Phelps, I believe. Carried the ball out to nearly the Phelps 20-yard line, where it'll be 3rd-and-2. Big defensive play for Pikeville. They need to hold Phelps here so that they can get good field position and have an opportunity to score here in this mid part of the second quarter. Mullins fakes, turns, and gives to his second back through. And I don't think he's going to have enough for the first down. Well, it'll be very interesting to see what Phelps does in this situation if they don't have the first down. The referees have called a timeout, an official timeout, to bring out the chains and measure this one. But from this vantage point in the press box, although we're looking at an angle, it doesn't appear that they got the first down. But by golly, they did. Yeah, in the middle of the field at around the 20 and 30 yard lines, we don't have much of a line left for the referees to mark the football or the chains. But it'll be 1st-and-10 Phelps from their own 21 yard line. Mullins over center. He takes the snap, turns and fakes to his backs. He's going to throw or try to throw. He does. He lets it go, and it's up into the stands. Well, that was smart. He's got a 2nd-and-10 now instead of a 2nd-and-20 or 25, because he had rolled out to his right and was about 10 or 15 yards deep. And certainly if he didn't throw it, he wasn't going to run out of there. Well, throwing our first down, which is always a risk, and it's proved costly to Phelps, because now they have a 2nd-and-10 from their own 20 or 21-yard line. And they certainly want to get out of this hole So if they do have to kick, Pikeville doesn't have good field position. Tight formation, a man in motion by Phelps. And that's that same play that gained 8 yards for them earlier, wasn't it, Andy? I'm sure he could have. But he only picked up two, and it'll be third down and 8 for Phelps at about the 23-yard line. What you would certainly anticipate being a passing situation, and Mullins, being the passer that he is, has a tight formation, comes out over center, takes the ball, fakes to his backs. Oh, turns back, and he hits his receiver over the middle, and a Phelps Pikeville defender fell down, and I'm not sure who that was. It may have been Brian Mahan, Andy. You know, that's, of course, the biggest gain of the night for anybody, but fundamentals are so important when you're playing under conditions like this. I think Brian caught himself turned inside and going the wrong way, and when the receiver came across the middle, he tried to turn back and chase and lost his footing. Had he stayed outside and played his position, I don't think he would have been caught in that situation. And you don't see Brian Mahan out of position very often. Excellent football player. First down for Phelps at the 43-yard line of Pikeville. Mullins turns and gives to his tailback, who picks up about 3 yards, where it'll be second and 7 or 8. Well, this is a big, big opportunity for Phelps if they can take advantage of it, Andy. I would agree with you. If you give Mullins some time, he's 6'4", he gets back there and he can see an awful lot of receivers out there. If you give him enough time, he can find somebody and really hurt you. Mullins comes up to the center. He has two wideouts right and two setbacks. He takes a snap and turns and gives to his second back through, which is rather surprising. Picks up about 2 yards to the Pikeville 39-yard line. Well, he didn't do what we thought he was going to do, Andy. Well, we don't like to see that, and two, it can be very costly. That can result in very severe penalties. Again, Phelps with the two wideouts to the right formation and a wideout left, two setbacks. Mullins takes the ball and fumbles on the snap and falls on the ball, and Pikeville falls on him. Andy Williamson indicating that he recovered the fumble, but I think they're calling the ball dead. Well, indeed, it did look like Mullins had fallen on the ball for Phelps. And it'll be a fourth down and 7.5, maybe 7 yards to go. And Phelps has their punting unit in, so they will be kicking the football. Big opportunity there that they lost on a bad snap. Phelps kicks. That's a nice kick under these conditions. Uh-oh, there's a flag. Brian Mahan called for a fair catch, and the ball bounced over to Robbie Wright, who caught it and advanced it, and you can't do that, can you, Andy?
Right, that's a legal fair catch signal. Any player on the receiving team calls for a fair catch, no one can advance.
Years ago in college, the person calling for the fair catch was the only player on the receiving team that couldn't advance a football. And I think in 1969, they changed that rule so that it's the same as it is in high school. If anybody on the team, the receiving team, calls a fair catch, no one else, and including, of course, the receiver, the one indicating the fair catch, can advance the ball, regardless of where it hits on the field or how it bounces. So that was a good call by the official. And of course, we could very clearly see Brian indicating a fair catch. That's a good point. He probably didn't, and the ball bounced in front of Brian and really almost upfield and to the side and right into the hands of Robbie Wright. The ball is at this time marked on the Pikeville 10-yard line. Oh, my goodness. Well, this will be interesting. Is that an elective process, or do they have no choice but to kick it over again? Because that's great field position for Phelps. I wouldn't think that they would want to kick this again.
I'm not real sure on where that penalty's marked from. If he advances the ball, there's two penalties there. There's an invalid fair catch signal, and then there's an illegal fair catch signal. The invalid fair catch signal, I believe, is marked from where the ball was picked up, and the illegal must be marked from where the ball was kicked.
Well, if we have the latter, then we'll have a fourth down and about 1 yard to go for Phelps for a first down. I would too. We have 4:30 left in the second quarter. And, you know, Phelps really hasn't shown anything offensively with the exception of this one drive. And I'm sure they would hate to waste it. And with a fourth and about a yard and a half to go, if they can pick up this first down, they are very much alive in this first half with an opportunity to score and tie this game up. And that's indeed what they're going to do. They're going to go for the first down. They have the ball at the Pikeville 36-yard line. It's fourth down and a yard and a half. Mullins comes up over center and looks at the Pikeville defense and calls a timeout. So we have a timeout on the field with 4:30 left in the first half with the score Pikeville 8. Phelps nothing. Ball, fourth and 1.5 to go. Mullins over the center. And now we see what they're doing. They're trying to draw Pikeville off sides with a long count, and they've been unable to do it. It's cost them two timeouts. They call another timeout, and I don't think they're going to punt. They're still going to go for it, Andy, because if they were going to punt, I think they would simply have called timeout. The coach would have had to come out onto the field, and they would punt the ball. They were trying to get the easy first down, and I think now they see that they're going to have to earn it.
Right, I'm sure Pikeville's coaches are making sure that those defensive linemen know to watch the ball. And Phelps will go ahead and run this play. I don't see him calling a third timeout.
No, and they are not. They come back now to the line of scrimmage, and there were coaches out on the field. Now that they're off, they've whistled the play for action. Mullins takes the ball, and on the quarterback sneak, I think he got it.
I believe Mullins went up and didn't use a cadence that time and just used a little motion with the center, and he snapped the ball and took off. Phelps did that a couple weeks ago against Elkhorn. It worked real well with the quarterback sneak. He doesn't make any sound when he comes to the line. The center just knows after he's been under there for, say, a count and a half, he'll go ahead and snap the ball and they'll go.
Well, I think it surprised Pikeville, and I don't think there's any doubt about what he picked up the first down. But they've called for a measurement, and the chains are out on the field, and he got it by a good 3 or 4 feet. Picked up almost an additional yard. So a real gutsy call there by the Phelps coach, and it paid off for them. So they now still have the football. It's now on the Pikeville 34-yard line where it will be first and 10. We have 4 minutes and 23 seconds left in the first half. Pikeville leading 8-0. Phelps comes up in a tight formation. Bobby Mullins, the quarterback, asking the official for some equipment assistance, and the official is trying to help him snap his chin strap on his helmet. He's now over the center. Right wing in motion. Again, Andy, that fake pitch to the tailback and gives to the crossing back up over the opposite side.
He picked up, looks like, about 3 yards. Andy Williamson tripped him up, or he could have had more.
That's been a good play for Phelps, but they have the same signs, the same indications every time they run it. They put the wing back in motion, turn and flip to the tailback toward the motion, and then give on a misdirection play back over to the other side.
Right. You'd expect Pikeville to pick up on that sooner or later. They've run the play now 4 or 5 times. Pikeville should be picking up on that.
Well, only a 3-yard pickup, perhaps 2.5. It'll be second down and about 7. And here they come with the wing motion to the right. Mullins takes the ball. Same play again.
He gets nothing there. Bobby Dramus really got through there quick.
Now, this time they had a little different twist in it. They faked the tailback away from the motion man. and gave it to the crossing back toward the motion. And they didn't get anything on that one. It'll be third down at about 7.5. Mullins over the center, takes a snap, fakes the pitch again, and then fakes that draw again. And he's caught back there, first by number 32, Andy Williamson. And he gets away from Andy. And then number 8 belts him, a good one.
That's Robbie Simpson right there on him, too.
Well, that was an excellent defensive play by Andy Williamson and Robbie Simpson. And that puts them now in a 4th-and-16 situation. So I think certainly with 2 minutes and 32 seconds to go in the first half, Phelps will punt the football because they don't want Pikeville to have a good field position where they could score with that little time left in the first half.
Exactly.
I think when Pikeville gets the ball, Andy, we will see them put the ball in the air if they get decent field position. Phelps is going to throw the ball. They're not going to kick it. Oh, no, I knew it was coming. They've called pass interference on Greg Hackney.
I don't believe that should have been called. I don't think that ball was catchable. You're not supposed to call a pass interference unless the ball is catchable.
I don't think the ball was catchable, and I think that the ball hit the ground almost simultaneously with the hit by Greg on the Phelps receiver.
That's right, and one thing that is emphasized on the pass interference call is if the ball's not catchable in the referee's judgment, it's not to be called. And he was reaching for that flag, it looked like, before the play happened.
There's no doubt about it, he was. When that ball was in the air and the Phelps receiver started coming back for it and he saw Greg running in the direction of the defender, he went to the flag with his hand.
Looked like he went to unbutton his back pocket to reach for it.
No question about it. And that's a big, big call because I think it gives them an automatic first down, doesn't it, Andy?
It is an automatic first down and 15 yards.
So Phelps retains possession again on what we thought was a bad call, but nevertheless, it's first and 10 from the Phelps, from the Pikeville 25-yard line. Mullins takes the ball from center and turns and pitches to his left halfback on a sweep right play. Very basic sweep right play, Andy, and they didn't pick up much, if anything at all.
No, that's just a basic student body right where you've got a tackle pulling and you've got two lead backs out there. I believe that's the play they're faking, the pitch to the tailback and hand it to the fullback. That's the play where they really do pitch it.
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe they thought they had set that sweep up with those other misdirection plays, but Pikeville didn't buy it. And very well defensed, and it's a 2nd-and-9 for Phelps. And Mullins again with the ball, and he turns and gives to his tailback over the right side, somewhat up the middle. And again, they pick up maybe half a yard. Looks like they're marking it right at the, just across the 25-yard line of Pikeville. It'll be, I think they lost some yardage on that one, Andy.
I believe it's on, looks like they're right at the line of scrimmage. I'm really surprised that Phelps hasn't thrown the ball and didn't throw the ball on that play. They've been real effective with it. They're getting the breaks, like with the pass interference call. And
you know, that's a good point. Good point, plus there's only 59 seconds left in the game, and they're going to have to stop this clock even if they do get a first down. Oh, good night. Great play by Brian Mahan. He intercepts it on the 25-yard line, and he may go all the way if he can get through this mud. There's one man left to get him, and he's tackled on a 5-yard line of Pikeville, or rather of Phelps. And that was an excellent defensive move by Brian Mahan of Pikeville. That was just a flat route. Very dangerous pass to throw, Andy.
Brian read that real well. He just cut in front of the receiver, and I really thought he was going to go. He had a couple of linemen to beat, but he ended up taking it 75 yards as it is. Pipe was right down there knocking on the door with 35 seconds left in the half.
Very difficult to run 70 or 80 yards in the mud, and but Brian did take it back to the 5-yard line. I think they spotted on about the 6. And with 35 seconds left in the first half, Pikeville has a super opportunity here to put another score on the board. You know, that's the very last thing in the world Phelps wanted to do.
That's right. Phelps was down there close, and now they've turned it over, and Pikeville's down there knocking on the door. Pikeville's called a timeout here.
That was a very, very poorly thrown pass by Bobby Mullins. I don't know if his receiver maybe again slipped, but he threw that ball right into the arms of Brian Mahan.
Yeah. Couldn't have asked for a better pass if Brian was a receiver.
That's right. And Brian did a good job of staying outside that time. He didn't turn inside, and he played his position real well. And he was in a perfect position to make that interception. So with 35 seconds left in the first half, Pikeville has the ball on the 6-yard line. And they probably can get off three plays or maybe four. I don't know. I think they have all of their timeouts.
They've got two left now.
Gene Benson turns and hands off to Andy Williamson over the left tackle, and he scores on the first play from scrimmage. So Pikeville capitalizes on a big interception pickoff. Brian Mahan, a big turnover. Of course, he returned that ball about 70 yards, and Pikeville takes advantage of it, and they go in for the score. So leading 14-0, having scored the two-point conversion on the first touchdown, Andy, they're going to go for the extra point this time and be satisfied with a 15-0 halftime lead if they can convert.
We have another timeout
on the field. So awaiting the extra point conversion, it's Pikeville 14, Phelps nothing. Having scored on a big interception by Brian Mahan and a run by Andy Williamson, the snap back to the holder and an excellent kick by Mike McCoy. Boy, he kicked that ball almost in the river. So with 31 seconds to go in the first half, it's Pikeville 15, Phelps nothing. 31 seconds left in the first half, leading 15-0, getting ready to kick off to Phelps, having scored a touchdown and an extra point conversion. And the numbers are getting kind of muddy. An onside kick by Sean Neely, and it won't go 10 yards. It gets mired up in the mud, but there is a flag on the play.
Looks like one of Pikeville's players may have been a little too anxious and was offside.
That indeed is the indication now. On a call like this, does Phelps have an option whether to?
They do have an option whether to let Pikeville kick it again or take the ball there. And I believe I would take it right there.
Indeed, they have elected to take the kick, and they'll have the ball on the Pikeville 48-yard line with 31 seconds left in the first half. Well, so we thought.
Pikeville does have, or Phelps does have an option on that. I thought sure they would decline that penalty and take the ball right there instead of giving Pikeville another shot.
Gee, I did too. I did too. Now they're going to, Pikeville's going to kick from the 35-yard line, I believe. And Mike McCoy will be kicking this time. That was Sean Neely attempting that onside kick. I'll tell you one thing. If they hadn't been offsides and had Sean kicked the ball hard enough for it to go 10 yards, Pikeville would have had an easy onside recovery.
They were right there on top of it. Looked like the Phelps players were just standing back waiting for it.
Yeah, they were. They had turned to go back and set up for probably a wedge return.
Right.
And I don't even think some of them saw the ball.
Right. I believe Pikeville's going to go ahead and boot it out of there now. They're getting down there. If Phelps gets it, they're close.
Well, here's Mike McCoy with a kick, and he kicks a rather short kick to the 30-yard line, where it's taken by Phelps and turned upfield, and he's tackled on the Phelps 44-yard line, where it will be first and 10 with 26 seconds left in the first half. Pikeville leading 15-0. And Phelps, I would think, surely would put the ball in the air.
They're going to have to here because they used their last timeout down on Pikeville's extra point. So they're out of timeouts and the clock's running. They need to get up to the line and get the ball off.
Of course, with 21 seconds to go now, down to 20, clock is counting down. They may come out and not even run a play. And well, they're going to run a play, but they may be satisfied with a 15-0 halftime lead, Andy, or being down 15-0.
They've got three split men to the right, and they're throwing the ball. He caught it. He's out of bounds.
A real nice pass by Bobby Mullins, but the fella couldn't hang on to it. A good lick up there by Andy Williamson, and with the half coming to an end, it's Pikeville.
Mrs. Raymond Rainey has been a marching band for University of Kentucky. Our next, ladies and gentlemen, Mike Gray. Our next senior is Julie Goff, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Sammy Goff. She has been a marching band for the past 5 years. She has been a member of all county bands for the past 4 years. She plans on continuing her education at PCC and teaching percussion at Pikeville High School next year. Ladies and gentlemen, Julie Goff. Our next senior is Mr. Robbie Moore, son of Rick and Jan Moore. Rick has been a member of the Pikeville Band for the past 3 years. Robbie was a member in the All-County Band for 5 years. Robbie plans on furthering his education in the field of medicine at the University of Kentucky. Robbie Moore. Our next senior is Miss Deanna Hall, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Pike Hall. She's been a marching dancer for the past 4 years, a member of the All-County Band for 5 years. Also, Deanna was this year's homecoming queen. Deanna plans on furthering her education in the field of medicine at the University of Kentucky. Our senior, Miss Deanna Hall. Our next senior is Miss Vicki Lane, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Vanderbilt. She's been a marching dancer for the past 4 years, and 2 years serving as flag captain. Vicki plays clarinet in the concert band. Vicki was a member of the All-County Band for 3 years. Vicki plans on furthering her education in the field of medicine at the University of Kentucky. Vicki is valedictorian of this year's 1987 senior class. Miss Vicki Lane. And last, our last senior, Miss Paula Rattler, daughter of Mike and Anita Rattler. She has been a marching dancer the past 5 years. Paula has been drum major the past 10 years, winning numerous first place awards. During concert season, she plays oboe. Paula is also a student body president. She plans on marching at the University of Louisville band and further her education in the field of English, and hopefully later in law school. Our senior drum major, Miss Paula Rattler. Time the marching panthers who will return next year wish the seniors the best of luck.
We're about to commence the second half with Pikeville leading 15-0 over Phelps. And Andy, in the first half, Phelps didn't mount much of an offense except for that one drive where they tried a couple of times on fourth down to get the first down. They were successful once and failed on the other time, very crucially failed, when Brian Mahan intercepted and ran the ball back to the 6-yard line. And on the ensuing play, Andy Williamson ran in from the 6 for a big Pikeville touchdown.
Phelps couldn't get anything going unless they were passing the ball, and then the pass ended up hurting with the interception.
A big kick here to kick off the second half. Robbie Wright takes it on about the 15-yard line and returns it upfield. Has some pretty good blocking. He's still on his feet and goes out to the Pikeville 41-yard line. Nice return by Robbie Wright, and excellent starting field position for the Pikeville Panthers to start this second half, Andy.
They got a good wall set up there, and if they had a couple more blocks, he might have broken. Pikeville's out just across the 40, and they're coming out quick, going right at Phelps.
Well, I hope they're as enthusiastic about this second half as they appear to be, because they did break that huddle with a lot of enthusiasm, and they're up on the line of scrimmage and ready to go. First down and 10, Gene Pinson in there again at quarterback. He's over the center, takes a snap, turns and hands it to Andy Williamson, who is tackled at the line of scrimmage by number 18,
Roger Kellyon.
Kellyon, 5'7", 150-pound cornerback, and I don't know if that play was designed that way, Andy, but nobody touched him.
Nobody touched him.
So it'll be
Looks like a little isolation. Maybe one of the backs missed his block and took off inside for a linebacker.
I would suspect that's what happened. Second and 10, Gene fakes and comes back and throws long to Andy Williams. He was wide open down the middle as about 6 yards behind all of the Phelps defenders. And that ball was very well thrown and just rolled off the hands of Andy Williams. Very muddy out there, and even though it's early in the second half, I'm sure that ball was very slick.
Oh, yeah. He ran a little play action there and fooled Phelps, and he got behind him and just off his fingertips, or it would have been six.
Oh, and indeed it would have been. That was a very well-thrown pass by Gene Pinson. Again, he's up on the line of scrimmage with a wide receiver right, takes a snap and drops back to pass, throws a screen pass to the left to Brian Mahan. That would have been a touchdown. They had that set up perfectly.
No doubt about it. He had four linemen in front of him on the screen, and it was right off his hands. I don't believe the ball being slick had anything to do with that. He just tried to turn up field too quick.
Boy, Gene threw that ball right between the eyes of Brian Mahan.
Right in the numbers.
Brian, I'm sure, very disgusted with himself. Pike will back to punt.
John Blackburn.
And John Blackburn.
That's a roughing.
He did indeed get the roughing, and he didn't even have to act to get it. That was back on the 32-yard line, and really, John got off a pretty good kick. He got off a kick of about 40 yards. Boy, he gets a foot into that ball. I don't understand why John doesn't kick all the time. Why Hillard would punt anybody else, I don't know, but that's why I'm up here and he's down there. But Phelps did indeed try to block the kick and rough John. What kind of a penalty is that now,
that's
Andy?
That's a roughing the kicker. It's 15 yards from line of scrimmage, and it's an automatic first down.
So a big, big break for the Pikeville Panthers here early in the second half. What was a 4th and 11 or 12 situation is now 1st and 10 at the Phelps 46-yard line. Pikeville in a tight formation with two tight ends and three backs. Timmy Honecker in there at fullback. Gene Pinson takes and fakes to his backs, comes back to throw again. He's got Brian Mahan wide open down there. A face mask there. Oh, heavens.
It's not called. I believe the referee just saw the back of his head.
Oh, my goodness, did he get face masked on that? That was pretty obvious, wasn't it, Andy?
Yeah, and I believe the referee just told him he saw it, and he just didn't throw the flag.
Now he does.
He throws the flag.
Well, a good job of persuasion by Brian Mahan. I think that after he spoke with the referee decided to throw the flag. Well, that was a beautifully thrown pass again, Andy.
It was right there, just over his shoulder, and he was right there. He's out of bounds on the 15. They'll take it half the distance. So it'll be first and goal for Pikeville from about the 7.5-yard line.
I'll tell you what, Gene Pinson has thrown the ball three times here in the second half, and every pass has been right on the money. And because of the conditions, perhaps, two of them have been dropped. But that one caught by Brian Mahan, and in a face mask penalty, takes the ball on down to the Phelps 8-yard line. It will be first and 10. Gene Pinson over the center, takes a snap, turns and hands off.
Bobby Doremus.
He never did go down, but they stopped his forward motion after a pickup of about a yard, maybe two.
I believe they're giving him forward progress at the 5-yard line, looks like, from the head linesman.
Yes, they are. So it was a pickup of about two and a half yards where it will be second and goal from the 5. They can't get a first down. Pinson over the center. He takes a snap, turns again, and hands off to Andy Williamson over the left tackle. And Andy runs the ball down into the end zone for a touchdown.
He had four blockers in front of him, and there was just no stopping him.
Pikeville very impressive here in the early going of the second half. And you know, I think they are a little enthusiastic, more so than they were in the first half.
I think they are. Gene Pinson came out. You wouldn't know it's wet the way he's thrown the ball, and they've run really hard, got good blocking, and they've got six on the board.
Well, again, Pikeville will try the extra point conversion with Mike McCoy back to kick. Here's the center. The hold is down. Oh, boy. Looked like another one of my golf shots. He topped it, and it barely cleared the line of scrimmage. So the extra point attempt fails, and with 10:15 left in the third quarter, it's Pikeville 21, Phelps nothing. It's a 21-0 lead early in the third quarter, Andy, and very quickly here it's looking very gloomy for Phelps.
It's a lot like the first time these two teams played. It was close at halftime, 14-15-0. That's relatively close, and Pikeville's come out real quick in the second half.
Pretty good kick here by Mike McCoy, and that ball will bounce up into the hands of the Phelps player. He fakes a reverse coming back left and then kind of slides down to avoid a tackle and gets the ball back to the 16-yard line Pretty good kick under these conditions by Mike McCoy.
Fine kick, and again, he tried to turn it upfield, and it looks like he just lost his footing.
You know, there again, under conditions like these, Andy, these fakes and reverses don't work very well because nobody has enough traction to even take the fake, and then after you've made the fake, you can't cut back upfield.
That's right. You find out who the hard runners are, and you get the straight ahead running, and that's what it's all about.
So Phelps with the ball first and 10 on their own 16-yard line. Bobby Mullins still in there at quarterback. He takes a snap, turns, and gives to his tailback coming through over the left side. Looks like a pickup of about 2 or 3 yards, where it will be second down and about 7 from their own 20-yard line.
You know, I don't know if you've noticed it or not, but it looks like Phelps is dragging a little. After the play is over, they're dragging, getting back to the huddle. They may be getting tired already.
Well, I'm sure, too, they're getting perhaps a bad attitude developing because they know how badly Pikeville beat them the first game this year, and now they're down 21 to nothing. And Mullins takes a snap, turns and hands off to the trailing back, and I think he barely got back to the line of scrimmage. You know, it's very easy for a team like that, Andy, to lose its get up and go when they get down 21 to nothing in the third quarter, and they don't seem to be generating any offense.
Yeah, coming out in the second half, getting that quick touchdown, that'll really take the life out of a team.
Yes, it will. Okay, we've got a third down and 7 now. Phelps on their own 20-yard line. Tight formation, send that wing back in motion left. There's that fake pitch and into the fullback up the middle, and he picks up. Boy, he may have gotten that first down.
He's looks like he might have it by about a half yard.
Well, that's been their bread and butter ground play, at least, in the first half, and this is the first time we've seen it in the second half, and it picked up about 8 yards, which is what they needed for the first down. Andy, at this juncture of the game, I believe it's almost imperative that Phelps goes down and puts some points on the board to stay in this football game.
They've got to score on this drive, or I really don't see them coming back, especially mentally. If they don't score on this drive, it's going to take an awful lot of life out of them.
Well, that was a big first down for them, and they have it first and 10 now at the 30-yard line, and Mullins takes the ball and hands the tailback over the left side, and he may have picked up a yard. They started at the 28-yard line, and they're marking it just short of the 30, where it will be second and 8 or 9 yards for a first down for Phelps. The rain has stopped, but the ground, of course, is still very muddy and slick. Very poor footing for the players. And again, on this drive, Andy, I would look for Phelps to throw the ball.
Second and 9 yards to go. I look for it here.
Well, they come out with two tight ends and a tight formation and a wing back to the right. They put the wing back in motion left, turn and give to the second back through. And he tries to cut outside and picks up about 2 yards, where he will be 6 or 7 yards short of the first down. We definitely, I believe, have a passing situation now for Phelps.
I'm really surprised Phelps hasn't thrown the ball more here in the second half. They got a couple drives going with it, with the break on the pass interference. They had a defender fall down. The offensive receiver always has the advantage in a passing situation because he knows where he's going, and the defensive man doesn't know where he's going, so it's easier for the receiver to keep his footing.
That's a good point. Another tight formation by Phelps. They send the wing back to the right side in motion. Mullins drops back and fakes to his backs and throws a perfect pass, but just couldn't hang on with the conditions being as they are. It looks like that ball went right through his hands off his shoulder pad, and had it stayed up in the air a little longer, could have been intercepted by Jody Miller for Pikeville.
Fourth and about 7. Phelps, I believe, is going to kick it.
Well, I don't think they have any choice but to kick it. They have the ball on their own 33-yard line. 6 minutes and 46 seconds left in the third quarter. They're down 21 to nothing, so they are in the punt formation. Now, Pikeville might look for a fake here, but I don't think that we'll see a fake punt. Centered back to the punter. He takes his time. Kicks a bad end-over-end kick, but it gets a great bounce, and Brian Mahan.
Got a running goal.
Oh, what a nice play. Running up the field, picked it up on a bounce, and took it back to the Phelps 42-yard line, Andy. That was a heads-up play by Brian Mahan.
He saw the ball rolling on a true roll, and he just got it run and go and took off. He made about a 20-yard return.
You know, a good point there is that he makes the 20-yard return. Had he let the ball go, I'm sure it would have rolled another 20 yards.
Another 10, 15 yards.
So that's a net gain, really, on a heads-up play of 35, 40 yards.
Right. That's the way Brian Mahan played all year.
Yes, he has. Very intelligent football player. Benson takes the ball from center, turns and hands off to Chad Thornberry, the first back through, and Chad picks up about 3 yards to the Phelps 40-yard line, where it will be second and 7. And I look for Pikeville probably now to stay on the ground and just...
I would say they try to eat up the clock now. They've got a 21-point lead. They're on the 40-yard line.
Benson over center. He takes a snap and turns and hands it off to Chad Thornberry again. And running hard, he breaks 2 tackles and gets 3 yards out of what appeared to be nothing down to the Phelps 37-yard line. They mark it at about the 37, and it'll be about second and a long 4, perhaps 5 yards for another Pikeville first down. Brian Mahan and Chris McNamee checking in for the Panthers.
You see Greg Hackney coming out. I'm real surprised that Hillard hasn't used him more. He's run the ball 3 or 4 times and picked up 6 yards at a chunk.
Gene Pinson gets the ball from center, and he comes back, and he rushes his pass and throws it way short, and Chris McNamee was wide open. You know, Gene sort of bobbled that ball a little bit at the center snap, and yet when he recovered it and started dropping back, I don't think he realized how much time he had.
I don't think he did. He had pretty good blocking there, and it was like he felt someone coming from behind.
Yeah, who wasn't there. He had plenty of time to set up and throw a strike to Chris McNamee. They're going to go for it on fourth down, and they're trying to draw Phelps off sides, and Phelps didn't quite buy it. They almost did. They moved, but they didn't penetrate that line of scrimmage. And then I suppose there's an imaginary plane that runs across that line of scrimmage that they have to break.
There's just a plane the size of the football, and it runs straight up. And anytime a head goes past it or even an arm, it is encroachment on the defense. Looks like we might have a timeout called here.
Well, we do. We have a Pikeville timeout with 5 minutes and 36 seconds left in the third quarter, with Pikeville leading Phelps 21-0. Draw Phelps offsides. Back to kick is John Blackburn. He takes the snap, and that's a fake punt, and he's got all kinds of room, and this could be a big gainer. John Blackburn runs down to the 11-yard line for a Pikeville first down. Boy, Andy, there wasn't anybody over on that left side for Phelps.
No, there wasn't. He had some blockers out in front, and you've got to remember John Blackman's a sophomore. He's a pretty good running back, so he's a good man to have back there at that punting position if you want to run a fake punt.
He is indeed, and of course, in my opinion, the best kicker from the punt position that Pikeville has. And once John gets out in the open, he's got a lot of speed.
Yeah, he does.
Gene Pinson over center. He turns and hands off to Big Timmy Honig with the first man through, and he barrels his way over 2 or 3 Phelps tacklers for a pickup of what appears to be about 6 yards down to about the Phelps 5 or 6 yard line. But I see a flag back there, Andy.
I believe it might be an equipment violation. I thought I saw a Phelps man without a mouthpiece in.
Well,
they're talking to Pikeville's captain.
Would that be like a 5-yard penalty? Would it be first and 5, or else decline the penalty and take it where it is?
Take it where it is, or it would be first and 5.
Well,
we haven't gotten a preliminary signal yet. They're still discussing.
Well, it appears that, we don't know what they're going to do yet.
It's going to be a first and 5, and it is an equipment violation against Phelps.
Well, they've moved the ball all the way down to the 5-yard line, where it's 1st and 2. Benson takes a center snap and gives it off to Andy Williamson, I believe. Now it's Bobby DeRamus. Bobby ran that ball down to about the 2-yard line. Now Pikeville could pick up a first down without scoring.
First down.
It'll be 1st and goal from the 1-yard line for Pikeville after DeRamus carries the ball for about a 4-yard gain.
Look for Timmy or maybe Fred Schoenecker on this play.
They've got John Blackburn in there at the left halfback position. Benson takes a snap, turns, and hands off
Doremus, he's in.
Was that Bobby Doremus for a touchdown for Pikeville? Yes, that was Bobby Doremus. So it's a touchdown, Pikeville. It's 27-0. And again, they send their kicking unit out on the field, and Mike McCoy will be attempting the point after conversion. The big play of this series, of course, being the fake punt and subsequent run by John Blackman, picked up about 35 or 40 yards, didn't it, Andy?
I believe he did.
Center, Brian Mahan, puts it down. The kick is good by Mike McCoy. So with 5 minutes and 3 seconds left in the third quarter, it's Pikeville 28, Phelps nothing. Pikeville about to kick off now after scoring their fourth touchdown of the game. 5 minutes and 3 seconds left in the third quarter. Pikeville leading 28-0, and I think that pretty much maybe could have closed the door on Phelps.
That's taking the life out of him for sure.
Mike McCoy kicks this one down to about the 15-yard line. Again, Phelps fakes the reverse, comes back, and boy, that's a nice tackle by Chris Newsom.
He stopped him dead right there. I know his pilot had some clean uniforms in on that kickoff. Some younger players getting some action.
Yes, they did. Those guys are looking like they just came back from the laundry. But if they play in this football game for a couple of plays, they won't look that way for long. Phelps now has the ball first and 10 on their own 27-yard line. With 4 minutes and 50 seconds left to play in the third quarter, and Pikeville leading 28-0. Bobby Mullins, the Phelps quarterback, still in there. They have a wide receiver out right and three setbacks. Mullins takes the snap from center and turns and hands off to his tailback off the left side, who picks up maybe a yard or two. Again, Andy, I think if Phelps is going to realistically have any chance at all to get back into this game, they're going to have to score quickly, and they're going to have to go to the air to do it.
Yeah. They've had some great opportunities with the pass. They've gotten some breaks. I don't see them not throwing the ball here. They've got to open it up and air it out.
Well, they've got a second and 9 situation from their own 27, 28-yard line, and a wide receiver out right. Bobby Mullins over the center. He takes a snap, he turns, he gives to his tailback again over the left side, and he picks up maybe one more yard, where it will be 3rd and 8. And again, Andy, I think we're both a little surprised that Phelps hasn't put the ball in the air. It seems like rather than try to win this football game right now, they're trying to make it not too bad.
Right. This 1 yard at a clip is not going to put 28 points on the board, and they've got to realize that. We've got 3.5 minutes left in the third quarter, and so that's 15 minutes left in the game. It's not a lot of time to score 28 points.
No, it certainly isn't. And as you mentioned, certainly not with the play selection that they've shown on this series of play.
Got a Phelps player down, looks like.
Well, we do, so apparently that's an official timeout. But he's up on his own now and walking off the field. That was number 12.
That's Mark Blankenship. I believe he just ran the ball.
Yeah, he's 5'11", 180-pound tailback. Pike was sending a lot of subs in. There goes Jamie Green in at the right defensive end position. Out comes Robbie Simpson. Phelps comes up to the line of scrimmage on a 3rd and 7 from their own 30-yard line. Wing back in motion to the left. There's that same old play with a fake pitch and a handoff to the man coming back.
Link Ritz was right there to put a stop to any gain on that play.
Well, they picked up. As a matter of fact, they lost a yard. So it'll be 4th down, and, well, no, they've moved the chain again. So he got back to the line of scrimmage, so it'll be 4th down and 7. And, Andy, do you expect maybe a fake punt here?
Phelps ran a fake punt in the Elkhorn City game a couple of weeks ago, and they do have it in their playbook. What they do is they'll snap it sideways. Bobby Mullins is up back blocking for the punter, and sometimes they'll snap it to him.
Well, they call a timeout, so Phelps with a timeout with 2:32 left in the third quarter of play. It's Pikeville 28 and Phelps nothing. Well, Phelps in the punt formation again. I think Pikeville looking for a fake punt. Bobby Mullins, the quarterback, up at the back position, and they hike it to the punter, and he kicks it. Pretty fair kick. hits on a 40-yard line and bounces into the hands of Brian Mahan again, and he turns upfield. And Brian trying to reverse his position, but it's just too muddy and wet, and he couldn't get any footing. And so about a 12 or 15-yard gainer on the return by Brian Mahan back to the Pikeville 48-yard line, where it will be first and 10 with 2:20 left in the third quarter, and Pikeville leading 28-0.
I'd just like to mention, too, for the people watching this film, it's foggy out there. It's not the camera.
That's a good point. I've seen a lot of televised games where the filming was very difficult because of the fog. Gene Pinson raises up on a quick look in. And again, that slippery ball bounces off the hands of Sean Neely and off the chest of the referee. He kept it alive there for a minute.
He kept it alive. It looked like one of the Piper players might have picked that off the referee's chest. Of course, that is a live ball. The referee's part of the field while he's in bounds. So he could have caught the ball and gone on.
Well, it'll be second down and 10 now. Gene Pinson over the center. He takes a snap, comes straight back, drop back. Oh, throws a little screen pass out and overthrew Robbie Wright and right into the hands of a Phelps defender.
That's Mike Sincell, the corner for Phelps, and it was just hit him right off the numbers.
Boy, I tell you, of course, it went right through his hands, but had he been able to maintain control of that ball, he might have gone 50 yards for a touchdown.
He had an open field right there. It's third and 10 for Pikeville. You look for a pass here.
Yes, they have Brian Mahan split out wide left, and they throw a strike to him, but Brian goes down to catch it on the Phelps 45-yard line. Nice reception, but, boy, again, there's just no footing out there for these kids.
No, Brian had to go down to catch that ball, and had the pass been a little higher, he might have been able to keep his feet. But a low pass like that, he goes down to make sure he catches it, and he does lose his footing.
Well, it'll be fourth down and 4 yards to go for Pikeville. They're in the punt formation with John Blackman again back to punt. Snap to him, and he gets a good foot into it and kicks the ball high and long. Hits on about the 15-yard line, and that ball's going to roll dead on about the 4-yard line of Phelps. Just another fine kick by John Blackburn.
That's about a 41-yarder for John Blackburn. That's a good average in high school or whatever.
I tell you, this kid in the games he has kicked this year has been just sensational. And I remarked during the Paintsville game, which was a very hard-fought football game, and Pikeville won, and without John's kicking, Pikeville wouldn't have been in that football game, in my opinion.
Well, Pikeville certainly has a fine future in their kicking game. They've got Mike McCoy and John Blackburn. Mike McCoy, of course, the place kicker, and both of these boys are sophomores.
That's right. They ought to have a strong kicking game for the next 2 years, and certainly John, too, will be a fine running back for them, and I'm sure Mike will play a lot of end for them the next 2 years. Phelps has the ball and sends a man in motion to the right. Mullins takes the snap, turns back, hands to their tailback, who gets back to the line of scrimmage for, I don't think he had any gain there. They're not moving the chains. Well, he lost about a yard. You know, they're down 28 points, Andy, and it doesn't appear that they have much of a chance of winning this football game, but they've got the throw to have a chance, yet they have the ball on the 3-yard line, where it's extremely dangerous to put the ball in the air.
Right, right. I'm sure what they're thinking is now they've got to run the ball to get it out. So they do have some room to throw it. But here we are almost the end of the third quarter, and they're down 28 points. They've got to put it up sooner or later.
Well, they have two wideouts right. Mullins takes a snap, and he runs a quarterback sneak. And he picks up about 5 or 6 yards. Gets the ball out to about the Phelps 11 or 12-yard line, but it'll still be a third down situation with what appears to be about 2 yards to go. Wasn't a bad call, Andy.
No, it wasn't. I believe it surprised Pikeville a little. They split two men out, and he was open up the middle to pick up about 10 yards.
Well, that's the end of the third quarter here at the Hamlin Athletic Center with Pikeville leading Phelps 28-0. Behind our audience out there, Andy, that these games are being brought to them by the Log Cabin Restaurant on Williamson Road, and we would encourage them to return the favor and pay Jimmy a visit. Fine food and beverages, excellent place for dining. Well, Phelps on a third and short situation picked up the first down. So they have kept this drive alive out to their 16-yard line. It'll be first and 10, but we're in the fourth quarter, Andy, and they're trailing 28 to nothing.
They've got to put the ball up now. They've got less than 12 minutes to go. They're down 28 points. They've got to put it up.
Out to the line of scrimmage with a tight formation. Mullins takes a snap, comes back, and gives to the tailback, and he is hit behind the line of scrimmage. First in there by number 8, Robbie Simpson, an excellent defensive play, and then he gets help from Link Ritz, Sean Neely, and Matt Blair. So he lost about 2 or 3 yards, looks like 3 yards, so it'll be second and 13.
Again, I'm really surprised that Phelps hasn't gone to the air. If they don't complete the passes, it stops the clock, it gives them a little extra time. And if they do, then they're up the field that much quicker. But they're staying on the ground. They're losing yards. He lost 4 yards on that play.
Yeah, that was a big loss for Phelps if they have any hopes of all at all of getting back into this game. Again, Mullins, 2 wideouts, takes a snap, comes back and puts a ball up into the air, and a nice pass caught by a player that we cannot identify because of the muddy jersey. Brought down immediately by Matt Blair.
Looks like number 32, Mike Fannin.
Mike seems to be able to do it all for Phelps, or at least what's been done by Phelps. Nice reception there in very poor conditions, but pretty nicely defensed that time by Matt Blair out there at the left cornerback position.
Well, I'm sure the cornerbacks are given a little bit of a cushion to avoid the big play, and just staying with the receiver. If he catches the ball, he's got a 6-8 yard gain, but he doesn't have the big play for the touchdown.
That's a good point. They're going to be laying back almost in a prevent defense. Again, Phelps up with a 3rd and 6 situation. 2 wideouts left. Mullins drops straight back, throws a screen pass out to the right side. Looks like there's plenty of room there, and he's picked up the first down. Again, we can't identify the Phelps receiver.
These white jerseys are really brown now that after they've wallowed in the mud for all night, and the numbers are just impossible to pick up.
I believe that was their fullback, Troy Gooslin. He's 5'8 and 185 pounds. It was a nice pickup for Phelps, but I'm afraid it may be just too little too late. We have 9 minutes and 45 seconds left in the fourth quarter. Phelps, of course, trailing 28 to nothing. Mullins up over center again. He has 2 wideouts left. He takes a snap and runs that quarterback sneak again, and this time he picks up maybe 2 yards. Again, I question the wisdom of that call, Andy. That, you know, with the clock running out, you're back down 28 points.
It's almost as if they're trying to run the clock out.
Yeah, and you know, keeping a defense honest at this point wouldn't be your primary objective.
Got to get some points on the board if you want any chance at all. And it being a playoff game, I'm sure that you do what you can to win. I just don't see a quarterback sneak as the way right here.
No. Mullins takes the snap. He fakes that sweep again and hands off to his fullback over the left side. And they pick up 2 or 3 on that one as the clock winds down. There's 8:45 left in the fourth quarter. And Phelps very surprisingly staying on the ground. Down 28 to nothing.
Seems almost as if Phelps is just content to get to the playoffs. It's what I've felt all night. They just don't seem like they want to win the game. They're just happy to be here.
Right, and two, I think they don't want the score to be too embarrassing. And at 28 to nothing playing Pikeville, it probably is not. Mullins takes a snap, fakes a play action, rolls out and throws a pass out into the left flat to his wide receiver, which is number 32. Again, that's Mike Fannin, who was split out wide left there, Andy, and made a fine reception, but was immediately brought down on about the 35-yard line, what will be short of a first down.
Hackney is given a cushion, as the defensive backs are. They're just trying to avoid the big play, and they're letting the man catch the ball and just bringing him down right there.
Well, it'll be a fourth down and 2.5 or 3 yards to go for Phelps. And again, they line up in a punt formation. And they snap it back to the punter. He gets off a good kick. It hits on the 38-yard line. And again, Brian picks it up on the bounce, and he heads right up the middle. And picks up about 8 or 10 yards back to the
Pikeville 42-yard line. And I tell you, Brian's doing a good job of picking up that ball.
He looks like a shortstop out there taking that two hopper and throwing the first.
Yeah.
He's just picking it up and going with it.
And, you know, as we commented earlier, that not only saves you or gets you the 10 yards he gets on the return, but he saves a good 15 or 20 yards from not letting that ball roll further downfield. So it'll be first and 10 for Pikeville at their own 42-yard line. 7:18 left in the ball game. Pikeville leading 28-0. Pikeville in his height formation. Gene Pinson takes a snap, turns and hands off to Chad Thornberry over the right side. Chad's hit and fumbles the ball after he picked up about 3 yards, and it rolls back to the line of scrimmage and is recovered by number 55 for Pikeville.
And that's Robert Mims.
That's a heads-up play by Robert. Several Phelps players around that ball.
Robert's just a sophomore. He's 5'8", 165.
This is a very young Pikeville football team. They have a lot of young starters, but they have a lot of young substitutes who are very good football players, and they're getting a lot of experience this year. Benson over the center. He takes a snap, turns, and fakes to his backs. Play action pass. He throws downfield to Link Ritz, and just a little underthrown, Andy.
A little underthrown. It didn't look like he had any problem gripping the ball. He just didn't get enough on it.
Intercepted by Phelps. You know, the ball looked nice. I mean, he had a nice spiral on it, and he threw it with a lot of zip, but he didn't get quite enough height on the ball, and I think Link had the fella beat and was on his outside by a yard or two, but not enough trajectory on that ball, and Phelps able to pick it off. So Phelps with the ball once again, and not bad field position, certainly better than they've had most of the evening. They've got the ball now on the 27-yard line, maybe the 26. That's their own 26. And Pikeville substituting a bit here on defense. Mullins over the center, takes a snap, turns, and hands off to his fullback. And after he did, I think he thought better of it.
Phelps had four wide men out there, and he had one long back, the fullback, and he hands it off to the fullback. 6.5 minutes to go. I can't understand this play call.
No, if for no other reason than your pride, I think Phelps would very much like to put some points on the board. And again, at least you and I are of the opinion that they've got to pass the ball to be able to score. They haven't passed it as much as we thought they would. They have two wideouts left. Mullins over the ball. He takes the center snap, backs up, straight drop back. Now rolls to his right, and he's chased by three or four Pikeville defenders, and he's caught for about a 7-yard loss, it appears. And I don't know what kind of routes they were trying to run, Andy. Everybody just goes downfield and starts to cut, and they just start slipping in the mud.
We may have just seen the reason he's not wanting to throw the ball right there, Neil.
That's right. Very difficult for your receivers to run routes. You can't run very cutting routes in this kind of weather. You've got to either slant across or just run fly route straight down, because if you start trying to run button hooks or cuts across the middle, the footing is so bad you just can't do it, and it takes so much time, and Mullins doesn't have that much time back there. He's
caught again.
He is. He's dropped again. He dropped straight back. He can't find a receiver, and he's thrown for about a 10-yard loss, and in three plays from scrimmage, Andy, Phelps has lost, it looks like, about 20 to 25 yards, where it will be fourth down and about 30 yards to go from their own 12-yard line. And with 4:32 left in the football game, I'm sure in this situation they will punt.
Oh, yeah, they're back deep. They're on their own 12-yard line, and you don't want to risk giving up six more points right here. He wants to just go ahead and kick it and get it out of there.
Well, the center to the punter, he catches the ball and gets off a beautiful kick, and it's going to be fielded by John Blackburn, and he tries to shake a tackler but can't do it, and he's brought down at the Phelps 40-yard line. But that was a real nice punt by the Phelps punter that time.
That's the best punt of the night by the Phelps punter.
Yes, it was, and the ball nicely received by John Blackburn under these conditions and tried to get a return, but Phelps had that punt covered pretty well. That ball had good hang time on it. So Pikeville calls a timeout with 4 minutes and 6 seconds left in this football game, leading Phelps 28-0. And on the Phelps 40-yard line, Matt Blair is now in at quarterback, and a whole lot of new faces Matt turns and fakes to the first back through, hands off to Bobby DeRamus, and Bobby has really turned it on, and he's gone for a touchdown.
He's in for
40-yard touchdown run, and that's the best speed I've seen Bobby display this year.
That's
Andy.
Amazing accelerations in this type of weather. He just accelerated and got outside, and he was gone.
Gee, that was a good-looking run. 40 yards out off tackle, and there were a couple of Phelps players who had excellent angles of pursuit to catch him, and he just outran everybody. Without a doubt, the speediest Pikeville player on the field or on the team. And Bobby takes it in from 40 yards out for a Pikeville touchdown, and that'll up the lead for Pikeville to 34-0. Well, now, wait a minute. This time he hands off to DeRamus. For some reason, they brought that ball back to the 8-yard line.
Looks like they said he stepped out of bounds. I didn't see it.
Oh, my goodness. I didn't see it either. I didn't think he was anywhere close to being out of bounds.
We don't have a real good view, but from where I was, I didn't see him step on the line.
Gee, I didn't either. I can see the sideline from here all the way to the end zone. apparently one of the officials felt that he stepped out, and they brought it back to the 8. Matt Blair with the ball. He turns and hands off to Greg Hackney, who fights his way with his quickness into the end zone, and that'll be a score, which will make it 34-0 Pikeville. That was an excellent run by Greg Hackney that time.
He's run hard all night, and I don't see why Hiller doesn't use him more.
Well, I tell you, Bobby DeRamus really impressed me that time with his speed.
Amazing. It was amazing how quick he got out there, and the ground's just soggy. And he just got out there. It's like he wasn't even hitting the ground. Those feet were just turning.
Yeah, you know, ground conditions like these will add 3 or 4 tenths of a second to a 40-yard dash. Mike McCoy in there for the extra point, and he boots this one again almost into the river. So with 3 minutes and 25 seconds left in the football game, Pikeville 35, Phelps nothing. 25 left in the ball game, scoring their 5th touchdown of the evening, now leading 35-0. Getting ready to kick off to the Phelps Hornets. Mike McCoy in there for the kick. He boots it, perhaps his best kickoff of the evening, down to about the 20-yard line. Again, they fake that same reverse on the return, and the Phelps player is hit immediately by number 21 for Pikeville.
That's Paul Rowe.
Paul Rowe making an excellent tackle on that return. And so it's about a 5-yard return. You know, Andy, under conditions like this, they run that reverse again where you really can't cut back up after you fake it. That kid probably ran 35 yards and picked up 5.
Right. Conditions like this, you don't want to run the outside kickoff return. You want to just set up your wedge straight up the middle where there's not a lot of cutting, and just take it straight at them.
You know, too, I think most coaches will tell their players on a short kick like that, don't do anything fancy. Get the ball. He fielded the ball on a 20-yard line. Come straight up field. He could have gotten it back to at least the 35-yard line.
Right. You know, it was a pretty high kick. Had a good hang time on it. It's going to give the kickers more time to get down there on you. So you don't want to play around with the ball. You just want to get it go. Looks like Pikeville's called a timeout here to get some new faces into the game.
Well, they have. It's a timeout by Pikeville with 3 minutes and 16 seconds left in the game. Starting to rain again, and Pikeville ahead 35-0 over Phelps. 16 left in this football game, and Pikeville leading Phelps 35-0. Phelps has a 1st and 10 on its own 25-yard line. Starting to rain pretty heavily now. Bobby Mullins with 2 wideouts left over the center. He takes the snap and turns and fakes to his backs, and I think they may have had a busted play there, Andy.
Looks like it from here.
Mullins looks surprised to find himself alone back there after faking to the 2 setbacks, and then sprinted out to his right and was able to pick up 1 yard. A lot of new faces in the game now for Pikeville. I see number 25 out there, David Cox, at the right cornerback position. We'll try to give you the names of some of these players as we can. Scott Stanley is in there at defensive end. Mullins drops straight back, throws a little pass across the middle, and it's picked off by Pikeville. Parker on a real nice interception, and again, the ground's so wet he couldn't make a return, but nice interception by Parker.
Real fine defensive play.
That was a quick look-in pass, and Bobby Mullins kind of hung that ball up a little bit and threw it over the receiver, and he was well covered by another Pikeville defender, but it sailed over the hands of both of them, and Parker came in from his defensive back position to pick that ball off. So now Pikeville has the ball with 2 minutes and 18 seconds left in this game. First and 10 on the Phelps 40-yard line. A lot of fresh faces out there. I don't think we have a starter in the football game. We now have a quarterback, number 14, Kevin Arnold, who is a 6-foot sophomore.
Looks like we might have a delay of game penalty.
Yes, indeed we do. A lot of new faces in there. And Pikeville penalized 5 yards for delay of game. We see Mike McCoy in there at the right end position. Kevin gets the ball, turns and hands off to
number 21,
that's Paul Rowe. Real nice job of running. And he picks up about 12 yards out to the 35-yard line of Phelps. Ball showed some quickness there. Pikeville with the ball, second and about 6 from the Phelps 35-yard line. Kevin Arnold takes a snap, turns and gives to John Blackman from the left halfback position. And John picks up about 3 yards. It'll be short of the first down, where it will be third and about a yard to go. Well, that looks awfully close, but they're near a yard line, so they don't call for a measurement. It'll be third and about 2 feet. Kevin Arnold takes the snap. He turns and hands off to number 30 for Pikeville, David Honaker. And looks as though David indeed picked up the first down. And they're stopping the clock to move the chains with 45 seconds left in this football game. Pikeville leading 35-0. A lot of new faces coming into the game for Pikeville, getting some much-deserved playing time. We have an official timeout, I believe. For what reason, I don't know. So we have a timeout on the field with 39 seconds left in the football game. Pikeville leading Phelps 35-0.
Coming off the field now.
Okay, Pikeville takes the ball, turns and hands off to John Blackman, who cuts outside and is brought down by a Phelps defender for a gain of about 1 or 2 yards. And the clock is ticking down with 25 seconds to go in this football game. It'll be second down and 8 for Pikeville at the Phelps 26-yard line. Pikeville will probably get one more playoff before the end of this football game. Kevin Arnold turns around to instruct his backs. He gets the snap, turns, gives to David Honaker, who goes off left tackle for a pickup of about 3 or 4 yards. And ladies and gentlemen, that will be the football game. Pikeville beating Phelps 35-0 in their sub-district playoff game. And they will now go on, Andy, to play the winner
of Bell County and Cumberland.
Bell County, that's down there around Pineville. And the winner of that football game, which most people expect will be Cumberland, will play here next Friday night.
Friday or Saturday night. It'll depend on how they want to set that up. But they will set it up on either Friday or Saturday night so that they don't have both districts down here playing on the same night.
Okay. So whatever night that is, we'll see you from the Hamley Athletic Center for the next district championship playoff game. And thank you for joining us.